Islanders!
Islanders!
Yes. New York Islanders! Woo! We're going after the Stanley Cup. New York, we are the world, the New York Islanders,
woo,
Islanders,
yes,
it'll keep on going and going. So, welcome. First ever edition of the Bubble Podcast.
What's up?
Special guest, Westfall in the house.
What's up, everybody?
Fess and T-Bone. What's up? What's up? How's everything going, everybody? We're just getting ready to set you up. Anyways. So, yeah. Let me get that thing muted in the background. Jesus. Well, I'm a fucking rookie. What do you want?
Goddamn. First time out, guys. Mistakes happen. Yeah. Rookie mistakes.
That's how we do it.
Training camp's about to start.
Yes. Training camp's coming up. All this prospect game tomorrow versus Philly's coming up. We got a couple of topics to talk about. Who's on there? T-Bone looks sexy on camera is the first thing that I see from anybody, and it's from Jack. How you doing? So, yeah, we got the prospect game coming up tomorrow, so I guess we'll touch on that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, you got the lineups?
Yeah, we got the lineup out here.
Obviously, first off, to start off, everybody knows we're going to be tailgating over there. We're going to do it up in the same spot where we were. You're welcome to bring a little bit of food to throw on the grill if you want. We'll have some other stuff there, but not a ton. So, you know, if you're going to be really hungry, definitely bring something. Bring your own beer. You know how we do it. We're going to be partying it up. Drums going to be going the whole nine yards. So, yeah, as far as the game goes, who's some of the top people that we're looking at?
Yeah, well, we got Barzal down here.
Yep.
Matthew Barzal.
Is that how you say his name, Barzal?
I think so.
I don't know how to say that.
It seems like it's one of those that's self-explanatory
to,
pronounce.
Yeah.
Doesn't seem like there's anything special to it.
Sounds like he's gonna need a unique ass chant.
Nickname. Guys gotta have a nickname.
Yep.
We gotta make it up for him.
Barzal. I'm sure JJ knows how to say that. Oh, Danny, what's up?
I see you.
So, yeah, so Barzal, that's definitely one that we're looking forward to. I know that that's JJ's favorite. He'll be out there looking forward to it, too. What's his number?
Barzal's number will be
13. Lucky number 13. Figures. Well, that's how it goes.
Peace, I see you.
Bill Guerin had number 13 in there. Yeah. Well, who else do we got? Who are you looking at?
Del
Cole?
Yeah, Del Cole.
Interesting to see Del Cole. Yeah.
Wait, who was the guy that was sleeping? Was it Del Cole that was asleep?
Jose was asleep. Yeah. The alarm clock is on us. We got you.
Yep, John Hosang's here too.
If we gotta pick you up and bring you to the rink on time, you give me a call. You holler at Westfall, man. I got you.
Oh, shit. Hey, BZ, what you saying? How Daly steals Collins' number. Oh, shit. Yeah, so that's a couple of good ones. Who else? Hosang, right? What's his number? Hosang. You just passed him there. We got some high tech equipment here. Playing in the background is just some stuff from last season, getting you ready for this season coming up. What number you say he was?
66.
Oh yeah. What's up with that?
Same number he's had for.
Same number as Lemieux. So he must love Lemieux.
Mad love.
I give Lemieux respect. First of all. I give Lemieux some respect because he was all around. He was an Islanders killer, which I don't fucking like. But I gotta give him respect. He wasn't a fucking. I mean, sometimes he was a douche. Yeah.
Not a Crosby douche.
Yeah, he wasn't nothing like some of the worst ones.
Now he's a softie as an owner, though.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. He ain't my favorite. He ain't no Islander. It's all about the Islanders.
Islanders!
Oh! Ooh, 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 ooh. No. Who's that? Kyle Shrimp? Is that Rob Shrimp?
No.
Oh. Nope, Bubba Gump. Shrimp. What was that chant? Yeah, that was a good one back in the day. Anyways. Yeah, the game should be good. We're playing against the Flyer. Who knows what? We don't fucking care who they got on there because it's all about the Islanders. There's going to be a couple of fucking little kitty Flyers out there. They're going to go back to Never Neverland where they belong. And we're going to be over there jumping around, banging the drum, you know, hopefully keeping the drum in the whole fucking time and not getting kicked out. But, you know how it goes. But
I wonder if Tanner Fritz has any relation to Mitch Fritz. Long time, sound time.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. Never heard of
it. Take it out,
why don't you look
that
up on that? What
Mitch Fritz, one love! I see you!
It's all about the Fritz. Oh, man. Good stuff, good stuff. So, yeah. Anyways, what else? Anybody else big names or no? Those are pretty much the three biggest names. Yeah. I don't see anybody else. I know their name. Who's that defenseman, maybe? Who's the guy that we drafted, goodness, yeah?
That's catcher Bellows.
Yeah, Bellows. He ain't gonna be there, right?
Keeper. He's gonna
Bellows.
Be there.
Oh, he will be.
Yeah, he'll be there.
I'll definitely be looking forward to seeing him.
Kyle Burrow.
Keeper. Yeah, keepers. Keeper's a keeper.
basically, all of our draft picks from the past like 3 to 5 years will be there. It seems like.
I don't know. I think Tavares was only drafted like 5 years ago. No, I mean, that was like 6 years or 7 years ago. It was 09, right?
I think we're going on 7 now.
Yeah, so yeah. Speaking about...
Craig, what's up, baby? I see you.
Oh, ooh, 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 oh. So, yeah. So, looking forward to the game. I don't know what kind of format they're doing. I don't know if anybody knows, but, you know, being that they're playing against another team, you would hope that they're just going to play 3 periods regular, but they'll probably do some silly thing at the end, you know, a force
overtime
or skills.
They might do like a shootout afterwards.
Yeah.
A small little shootout. But they'll probably do a regular prospect game, like just the two of them going at it. They'll probably swap out the goalies at some point.
Yeah, true. Definitely. That other guy from the KHL ain't here, right? Because he's in the KHL.
Soderstrom? No, Soderstrom's here.
No, not Soderstrom.
Soderstrom is here.
Soderstrom.
Mine is Soderstrom.
No, it's Soderstrom.
Nah,
it's
not the guy that I'm talking about. That's the guy I'm talking
Sorokin.
About.
Sorokin.
Oh, yeah,
that's
the
Sorokin. One. Yeah, he's from Moscow.
Moscow.
Yeah, I think he's
yo,
here.
I was at a KHL game. That shit's crazy. They got that.
So did the Russian make love to it.
Got my KHL hat right over there. Taro. Oh, Taro. What's up? Shout out to Taro out there in Finland. Oh. So, yeah, I guess. That other goalie, if he's playing, that's I'll be looking forward to him. Sorokin.
Sorokin,
whatever. I don't know how to say his name.
We'll find
don't
out.
Make
we'll
fun of me, Tom.
No,
stop
I'm,
making fun.
I'm not making fun.
You're gonna learn.
I'm joking. Yeah. So I don't know. Hopefully it's good. We'll be up there cheering, having a good time, regardless. Nice little local home game. You know, we gotta love that. You know, everybody wants to have some local home games. That's right there, friggin' 5 seconds from the Coliseum. You can almost hit a baseball across the friggin' Meadowbrook today. So, it'll be a good time. It'll be a good time. I'm sure that we'll be out there reminiscing about how it was at the Cali. You know, tailgating and all that good shit. Miss all that, of course. That's how it goes. But, you know, of course, since we got Westfall here... You know, and being that it's the first episode of this new podcast that was starting up, and we'll have other guests come in. Oh, yeah, he's sitting on the Coliseum seat, as any other guests will do, too. Silent Phil, you'll get in here. yeah, so being that we got Westfall here, we figured that we'd also touch on, you know, for once on a live video and all that, you know, touch on how the whole thing really kicked off, because for if anybody doesn't know, Westfall is the original back row boy. You know, that's where it all comes from there, that whole thing. He'll tell you. I don't want to say it all, but, you know, we wanted to touch on that while we got him here. Live in action. So, yeah, I guess where did it start off? Where did you, you know?
Well, it started off basically... My man Silent Phil, my partner in crime. One love. going to games together. You know, we were just sitting in the, you know, like we were sitting up at 329. We actually started at 328, actually. Started at 328 in the last row, 328. And we were kicking it up there, going games, drinking beers and stuff like that. Phil was my designated driver. Love you, man. You know, like, so we were going to games, and then we see these kids down below at 329 in the lowest sections. My man T-Bone's brother there, you know, him and his boys were chanting. They had the beaker out, you know, and we were up there chanting, "Let's go Islanders." They were up there joining us. So we decided, you know, like, I think it was 2007, to, like, move over to the 329. Phil, if I'm wrong, man, like, I think it's 2007, 2008. You know, if I'm wrong, chime in. But yeah, so then we were up there. It was, like, me, Phil, this guy, Bill, young guy, Bill. I don't know if you're watching, Bill, man, respect, dude. And then we had, like, a father and his two sons that they would rotate coming to games, or they were, you know, basically the job was just to, you know, when the puck dropped, it was time to go, it was, you know, get a nice "Let's Go Islanders" chant going, you know, doing whatever we can to get the people riled up, because we were going through some lean times. It was tough, man, but still we were coming out, you know, whenever we could. So, I believe, like, I forget what year it was, but when did they do the loud bill?
07, I think?
07?
Yeah.
And then 2007 comes around. You know, we're still up there creating havoc, getting hammered every night, partying, doing what we do best. You know, and then all of a sudden these kids show up, Loudville, you know, and we heard that they were getting free tickets. Somebody told us they were all getting free season tickets, and they were down low. They were closer than we were, all the way in the last row. They were all the way down. And their job was to be loud. It was like, what the hell is this, man? So, it was, you know, it was funny, like, you know, and there was my man here, T-Bone, Will, Tess, Justin, right?
Yeah,
Justin,
Pinhead.
Pinhead, you know, and they were chanting, we were chanting, and it was like, wow, man, you know, like, this is cool as hell. And then, what was it, 2008, summer 2008?
Yeah, the 08.
Summer 2008, we got together at a little, with Applebee's and the Roosevelt Field Mall. Remember that place? What was it, the mall?
Yeah.
One Love Applebee's. And, you know, we decided to put this thing together, man. Mm-hmm. The fall of 2009, we debuted as the Blue and Orange Army. You know, we've been doing this ever since. You know, I mean, like, you know, my man here, Fess, T-Bone, they carried the torch to Brooklyn. You know, like, they're doing a fantastic job. You know, everybody out there, you know, banging on the drums. Man, we didn't even have a drum at the Coliseum. I wish we had something like that. You know,
we'd never get it in there.
Sweet spot. Yeah, I don't know if you're in there, Grambo. Sweet spot. Oh, yeah, man, that upper deck that had that the metal, the back row.
Yeah.
And you could find the right spot where the crease was and just smash on it. It was a little gum mark right on the sweet spot too. If you hit it just to the side of the gum, it would fucking rock in the whole building, especially when it wasn't packed. The whole building would echo like fucking. You just hear it like whoa, whoa, the sound fucking going.
That was pretty often back then.
Yeah, yep. That's how it is.
Oh, Jared, that's right, man. I forgot, dude, about the black hole, man.
Oh yeah, the black hole.
I should have brought that up.
This is the black hole.
Yeah, man. Originally, before the whole BOA thing, man, before the whole bubble block and all that stuff, we were just the black hole, man. That's all it was, just the black hole, just. Black hole, just doing all kinds of, we could sacrifice goats up there, you know, just be crazy loud and just, you know, like I said, like, I think every game I was banged up, you know, hammered, but it was all about having a good time, man. You know, like, whether they won or lost, we'd be pissed off and stuff. You know, they lost more than they won back then, you know, that's changing now.
Half the time we didn't even really,
like, we were just there to have a good time, you know, like, we were all buddies, just
waving our pirate flag.
Yeah, we had the pirate flag. Yeah. Whoever stole the original pirate flag, I'm gonna find your ass, I'm gonna whoop it.
Yeah, you better look out.
You know, better watch out. Stole that flag. I can't believe they stole that flag, man.
I can't believe they stole that flag, you know.
But, Pinhead's doing a great job. You know, respect, man, wherever you are, man. I see you, baby. I love you.
He's coming back from his trip right now.
He's coming back from Chi-Town.
Yeah, baby. So getting ready for this season, getting ready for tomorrow.
So, yeah, man. You know, like, you guys out there, you guys got to come out to the games. I know I got to come out to the games. Oh, married and stuff like that now, trying to buy a house and stuff. So, you know, it's not as much, I'm not as prevalent as I was back in the day. As a matter of fact, last time I went to the Barclays Center, some people up there didn't even know who I was, and I kind of thought that was pretty cool, you know. You know, like I said, I kind of like
people still don't know.
I could be the shadow, man. So I like that. That was pretty neat. You know, people are like, who are you? We don't even know you. Good, man. I'm glad.
Yeah, glad. Until you were banging the drum off of the edge of the frigging cliff, and they had to come and tell me what's going on today.
Yeah, right.
And I was like, don't worry about it, guys. This is how it's going. I mean, the security came up to me or whoever it was and was like, what's going on today with that drum? You guys are going nuts. And I was like, yeah, we are. I don't know. This.
Looks like, Craig, this t-shirt, this is the original 329 t-shirt with our custom-made logo. We haven't really been able to get around to making new t-shirts, but it's definitely part of our new plan, along with some other custom t-shirts that we've been working on.
That's Will's.
That's Will's design. John wants to know how many Westfall appearances are gonna get this season.
I don't know yet, man. I gotta check out.
Can
the
we open up the comments?
We gotta pull up this. Yeah. You know, the comments are flashing by quick on there. Sorry for any ones that we're missing right now. We're gonna look back through all that though too. So stick with it. Stick with us. Yeah, you should be able to see it when you go scan back through the thing. Usually, I see it. I don't know. I watched some other live ones out there before.
All right, there we go. There we are.
You know who you are with the liveness. You keep it live.
There it is.
All right. So whatever. Yeah, where the we got?
Ask
here we go.
Well, I'm gonna try to come out as much as I can. You know.
Where is Griggs? Lenny S. Lenny, I don't know where Griggs is at right this moment.
Probably with the ice girl.
He might be with the ice girls. Or Sparky. I got a Sparky bobblehead. Move your head over just a little bit. There he is. Sparky bobblehead is right over there, Griggs. Oh, we got you covered, baby. That's how we do it. What else we got? Silent Phil. Soccer Ann is tearing up in the KHL. That's the guy that I was talking about. Yeah, that's the thing. He's in the KHL. He's not going to be there tomorrow, right? He's in the freaking KHL. That's what I'm talking about. Silent Phil speaks.
Speak. Speak on it.
Did any of you play hockey at all, John Dunn? Actually, yeah, I used to play. It's funny you bring that up. We were just saying before about that that rink, the Miracle Rink, the freaking Lake Placid. I played up there. I played in some Montreal, the Les Four Glaces. Those ones were great because, you know, we got to go out and party in the city and stuff, especially when we were kids. Went to a Montreal Expos game up there and all that, but. Yeah, I used to play in the high school hockey league here in Long Island, and sometimes we'd go on those trips. But it was always, what the fuck? The shit is frozen like this. I don't know if you can see it.
That's because you have to hit play.
That's not what we're laughing at. Oh. We're laughing at the fact that Craig wants Westfall there with the kilt.
Oh, shit. Hell yeah.
Gotta break that out of the closet.
Anything worth doing is worth doing right.
Dust it off.
And Tony Banana, we need you to wear the damn banana suit already. Come on, people. Let's help get the petition to get the damn banana back in there. And if somebody wants to buy a Niles suit, I'll wear it. Just saying. what you got on there? What did you say? What else did you go pass up? Pass them all.
No, we're up to date now. Because everything else is...
Yeah, but the other ones... Well, either way. In there. What's that about Sparky?
Fighting for Sparky. Yeah,
I mean, fighting for Sparky's on. Yeah, man. Mano.
Sparky's our boy. I love Sparky.
What does that say? Half missed on the Expos mention. Half. Yeah, Ryan Hafner. He missed it out. Shut up, Hafner, with the Expos.
Read that now, baby.
Oh, man. Good people, Haf. Good people. Going to be looking forward to seeing him, to seeing everybody as the season starts. I hope that everybody's going to be there tomorrow. It's going to be a fun time. You know what I mean? And just to touch a little bit more on how the whole thing started, you know what I mean? Just for, I think, maybe T-Bone, for you, how did it all come to be?
How did it all go down?
Yeah.
Yes, John, I got this haircut just for the live special. I decided to look my best. Yeah.
At least you got hair.
Shortcut, T-Bone.
It basically started the same way Westfall. And, like, I joined around the same time with Pinhead, Will. But I had already known about everything. Oh, you knew that them West from school,
maybe,
in.
Right?
What?
You knew them from school, yeah, maybe, before?
Yeah, well, I knew Pinhead from school.
Yeah.
Snyder, I see
you. So I saw, you know, so I met up with Pinhead, and then we would talk, like, Pinhead introduced me to Will and Justin on the Loudville line.
Mm-hmm.
And then there was the whole segment of Islanders United, which was what Westfall was referring to, where they were so desperate to get people in the building, people like us, to be loud, obnoxious, and have fun, and make it sound like people are actually there. And, you know, that's when they decided to offer us season tickets for $10. And it was like, who offers that? I mean, of course you're going to jump on
it. The Islanders do.
That's when Westfall was kind of like, oh, no. Found out this guy.
Shout out to Ariel with the deal.
This guy got $10 tickets. You know what? Screw these guys. And then he realized that we were just a bunch of idiots. Just like, just having fun. Hearing about the Islanders, you know. Later, like during the 08-09 season, you know, the season that we were most awful at, that led us to the Holy One, John Tavares.
Indeed.
That was when we started going back and forth with Westfall.
Yeah.
Every
time
Tavares.
We gave up the goal, every time they scored,
we would all chant John Tavares.
John Tavares chants.
When we would score, John Tavares. Yep. Just it became John Tavares mania up there.
Yep. Every game.
You know, and then finally, during that off season, we decided to take things to the next level. Let's unite. Let's try to form a group out of this. And so, you know, we got together. We talked things over at Applebee's, which Applebee's is always a fantastic choice, especially late night for those apps. You know? So.
Where T-Bone will be in T-minus something.
Yeah, 45 minutes.
Yeah, so.
T-Bone's girl, I see you!
We just talked about it, and one thing led to another, and we finally started to get everything together. And I honestly had no idea that it would grow this much. I figured it would grow eventually, but not this many people this quickly.
Yeah.
And joining with Hardcore definitely helped that.
Yeah.
And the fact that last year was such a roller coaster ride, you know, at first, with people not really feeling the chanting or anything, and then eventually the entire section was doing it. And I mean, you know, if we just continue to bring that same attitude every night, players are gonna know that we're there, they're gonna ride off of that, and we're gonna win a lot of games.
Yep. And it was a big learning curve for a lot of people this last year, you know, because
still learning.
There was a lot of new members to the Blue and Orange Army.
New members,
you know?
new home,
new arena at the same
new
time.
New way to get there.
New travels.
I mean,
new
we do
pre-games,
have to take the time to thank
games.
To thank the owner of McMahon's for taking us in like family.
Yep, Mike. Yeah, he's a great dude at McMahon's. You know, everybody knows. You know, and if you don't know, that's the spot over there, especially for the Blue and Orange Army. We'll be up there upstairs. That's how we do it. You know, and shout out to the bartenders there too. Always the best. You know who you are, Allison. Oh, and
so what, Westfall? Do you wanna take this question?
Adrian D writes, one of my best friends just started dating a Rags fan. Do I end the friendship? Need advice. What you should do is get yourself a nice baseball bat and crack the boyfriend over the head. And take back your friend. That's what you should do. And that's Westfall's wisdom of the hour.
Oh, Westfall's words of wisdom, yes. What is JJ saying? Alright, don't skip ahead. I'm
JJ's
sorry.
JJ's got. JJ says, our goal this year is a shut up Lyle chant throughout the park.
Barclays Center doing it.
If the entire Barclays Center manages to do that, I think that's
God
just
bless.
Yeah, God bless. And I'm pretty sure half the Barclays Center will be thinking,
"Who's Lyle?
Yeah, who is Lyle?
Who the hell is
and
Lyle?
Why are we telling him to shut up?" And then once they find out who Lyle is, they'll realize,
"Shut up."
That's why.
There we go.
I mean, I'm for one really happy to see PA Parento back. we bring back one of our older chants.
Yeah.
Fez, that's one of the ones that you first brought to the section.
That's what Mano was saying here about the Parento chant. First time that he was looking up being like, what the fuck was going on up there? Yeah, no, I think
we're still
that was one of the chants that I made right there. Fiales Parento. That was
before they ever played out that song for the power play. And we used to do it so loud, our little group that was doing it, we would just do it to the top of our friggin' lungs, and they would hear us in the whole place, and then they started doing it over the loudspeaker. But granted, you know, we had little ins with, Roger, right? Kind of knew him, so. Friends with the friends, you know, one thing leads to another. What was that asking about the peanut butter and jelly? A good way to meet peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Let's see.
Slice of white bread. Peanut butter and jelly. Slam. And that's West Falls kitchen effort of the day. There you go.
And then the best thing to do with it afterwards is open it back up, find yourself a Ranger fan and go, hey. That's the best way to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich.
I waste food on that.
No.
I waste
it's
food
not
on
a waste. That's not a waste. That's not a waste. That's a good use for it.
What the food do?
Unless
then?
You want a nut. I think Fez likes to eat his with nuts.
Oh, yeah.
He's a crunchy peanut butter kind of guy.
That's a lot, man.
Oh, man.
He's a Sabres fan also. I'm sorry to hear that. You're divisionally challenged, or actually conference challenged.
Well, crack that guy. Well, they'll get it.
That's that Lyle.
Oh.
Yeah, that would do it.
Lyle takes a beating.
Always, yeah.
Look, Christopher Rawlson.
Y'all suck. Go Habs, go. Get out of here with the Habs, Chris. The first time I ever met Chris, I gotta say, because it's a funny-ass fucking...
Oh, that's
so
funny.
I'm out there in the smoking section, and Chris comes up, and he's like, you got a lighter? I was like, not for you, Habs fan. He was like, what, motherfucker? And I was like, what you mean, motherfucker? And then the next thing you know, there was people in between. I don't remember the parts after that. You know how it goes. That's the dangerous parts, but nothing happened. We were all good. And then the next thing you know, 2 minutes later, I walk up into the section. I'm like, Westfall, what's up? And then Chris comes up from the other side. He's like, yeah, what's up, Westfall? I'm like, what the fuck? I was like, this is your friend, dude? I was like, this guy's out there fucking trying to get my lighter. This man. I was like, no.
What's up, Chris?
Oh, Chris, you're a good dude, Chris, but the Habs are going to get beat. So just so you know.
Thanks for watching. Thanks for staying. Thanks for playing.
Oh, man. Good stuff.
What else we got? Anybody else?
Yeah, what else? No, there's
all. There we go. Adrian. Yeah, man. How many times did we... Hey, all of us throw
out. Yeah, that was good times.
I can't tell you how many...
We lost our voices.
We got to work the next day and...
Yep. We got some new chants coming up this year, too. Some good new chants coming up. Some of them are really easy. So, you know, those ones usually work out the best. Nice and catchy little chants.
Like Josh Bailey.
Yep.
Which is kind of funny that he's so... That, like, people don't like him that much, but that chant has become so popular.
Oh, yeah.
It really doesn't make any sense.
You remember
sense.
In the playoffs, the people were all doing it all around?
Yeah.
And with the drum or the oh, the whole place was doing it. That was crazy for me. As far as I was concerned, that was fucking nuts.
Meadow, now is not the time, and there is no Night of Champions. That's actually Clash of the Champions.
Is that a wrestling?
Yeah, it's a wrestling.
Night of Champions.
That's not the time.
Night of Champions.
I mean, Night of Champions, it's always the Islanders, right?
Yeah. Islanders.
I'll always go with the Islanders.
Cuatro Champions. yep. Of course, we'll, you know, also
Chris, Jeez. We love you, man. I love you,
buddy. What's that phrase up in that ICU? Mosh
Mars,
right?
Or whatever that
Mosh
is.
Mosh Merge. Mosh Merge. Mosh Merge. Oh, DeLuca, the quality sucks? It's off my phone, bro. I'm going to upgrade it. This is just the first show. We're going to have some more. Consider this the opening ceremony, something.
Chris says we need to move the camera closer.
I don't want the camera too close because the camera adds a couple hundred pounds. That's already wide frame.
Oh. Yep. So, yeah. We got... Who's on there? Oh, Jen, what's up? Roach, oh. Looks like 8-bit.
Damn!
The video quality sucks. It's not meant to be perfect. This is home blogging, or blogging, whatever you want to call it. Not supposed to be,
Adrian says that
aliens.
That you can hear us all the way across the country while they're streaming the live games, and it makes her homesick. And you know, Adrian, we miss you too. And you know, you're always welcome to come out because you know we treat mom like family, and we really hope to see you and Eric at the Barclays Center soon.
Barclays Center, one love.
Oh, rock the bark, baby. Yeah, Boa like Noah, and the bark is the ark. We need two of everything.
Let's see.
Two of everything, I say.
All right, JJ wants to know if I think Barzal is making the team. JJ, I'm not really sure right now. I mean, it's gonna come down to how everything goes in camp, especially while the worlds are still going on, the World Cup of Hockey. Where Yaro's doing a pretty good job of
playing for Team Europe.
Yeah, but I mean, he's actually playing well.
Listen, let's talk about this. Let's talk about this World Cup of Hockey. What are they doing? They got Canada, they got USA, and they got North America.
Yep.
Kind of fucking shit.
That's not really. That's
because they ran out of.
They ran out of countries.
Man. I don't know.
When it comes to Barzal,
maybe they can make East Canada, West Canada, East America, West America.
It's a joke.
But when it comes to Barzal,
it's not my favorite thing, that's for sure.
Back in 2004.
Kind of tough to figure out. I mean, Fess, what do you think? Do you think Barzal makes the team out of camp? I mean, I think it comes down to how he plays.
Can we bring up the roster really quick?
No, that's training camp. I mean, that's the scrimmage camp. That's not the actual camp.
You're talking about making the roster, right? Yeah, the real roster.
Yeah.
Let me just look at something really quick because off the top of my head, obviously there's a bunch of guys that are going to be definitely. Look at Craig in the video in the background there. I see them doing some sprinklers.
Sprinkler, man.
Hold on. You know what song has got to be going on then in the background. Hold on. What was this? The one time they ever played the song?
That's the one time they ever played it completely.
I don't know how long you guys kept that up for, Jesus.
Oh, he definitely did it the whole time. There's Steiner up there. Oh, Kenny Morrow's over there. Yeah, we just got some stuff playing in the background.
So. There we go. There's the roster, boys.
All right, the roster. So, for forwards, guys that'll most definitely be in there, first of all.
We should talk about the lines if we're going to try to figure out how he's going to.
It'll be easier
to figure out where he's going to end up.
Analysis from the source.
Hold on, though. 12 forwards. Yeah, Bailey, Chimera, Cizikas, Clutterbuck, maybe Kuhlman. I'm going to skip Grabowski. I skipped over Bolton, too. Led, Lee, Brock,
Parento,
Prince,
Quine, Strome,
Tavares is 13. So, not Quine, so Strome and Tavares. So, if Barzal is making it, then you're probably looking at... Because, you know, Brock and Lee are both going to be there. Broccoli. What's up, Broccoli? How you doing, Broccoli? They're both going to be there.
It'd probably be easier.
But I counted Kuhlman. He's playing, though, in the Worlds and all that, right? So, he'll be in. But Grabowski, they were saying, probably isn't going to be ready. I saw
that Grabowski is on track to be cleared and ready to go when camp opens up. So that makes things a little tricky. I mean,
so
if you
take out Prince out of the equation.
If you think about the lineups, you're probably looking at Tavares, Lee, and Parento. I mean, that's a no-brainer. Then you're looking at our second line of most likely being Strome, Lee, and Bailey, probably. I feel like that's most likely to be our second line.
I can see that.
Our third line will probably be Nelson with Prince and Kuhlman right now.
Maybe.
I would say that would be our third line as of now. And then our fourth line is Chimera, Cizikas, and Clutterbuck, our killer Cs. So it really makes things difficult to see if Barzal will make the roster, because he has to jump most likely Grabowski, Quine, and Prince at least. He has to jump at least those three, as my guess.
Grabowski is more if he's injured, not if he's jumping them though.
But
jumping Quine and Prince, definitely, yeah, he would have to jump Quine and Prince.
Because then you'd probably see him on the third line to start out with Nelson and Kuhlman.
He would have to be on the third line at least if he's playing. Obviously, he's not going to... The fourth line is the fourth line. Because
you wouldn't
want to
put him on the second line with Strom, Bailey, and Lee, because that line is most likely going to have to deal with the defensive problems. Like, they'll have to guard the top lines and everything. And you want Barzal out there against the third and fourth lines.
Yeah.
Chris Carlson has always the best commentary.
Sandstorm.
Chris, you need to do your own podcast.
JJ
says, your own thing, man.
JJ says Grabowski's going to get hurt.
Probably.
I mean, I'm still kind of surprised that he's still working so hard to get back in the lineup after what he took, maybe two or three concussions last season alone. I would have thought that that would have done it for him. Like, he would have called it a career after that.
Yeah.
I mean, Mike wants to know a second line of Ladd, Strom, and Lee. We spent a lot of money to get Andrew Ladd, and he's that top scoring winger that we wanted with John Tavares.
I don't know if I would putting call him the top on the scoring second winger. Line. I don't
but
know if I would say that.
He's the veteran scoring presence.
Scoring isn't the word that I would use, though, because he's more of all around. Yes, he needs to score some goals. Yes, but he's a multi-purpose guy for sure. And that's a multi-purpose offensive purpose kind of guy.
I mean, he has a lot.
And that's a good thing to be.
There's a lot of positives to Andrew Ladd. His scoring abilities.
Yeah.
His ability to get to the dirty areas, battle it out in the crease, his leadership values. I mean, he was the captain of Winnipeg for a while.
Mm-hmm.
He's been to, two Stanley Cups with the Blackhawks, I think?
I think so.
So, he has the Stanley Cup pedigree. He's basically the veteran that the Islanders have been trying to get for so long that's still in his prime, and that will be what really helps out John Tavares. And a big body like Andrew Ladd is going to open up the ice for John Tavares to do John Tavares things.
Exactly. He's the right kind of player.
He's the Okposo replacement we need. One more 30-goal scorer.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Definitely 30 goals, but that's my thing. It's, for me, a pure goal scorer, you need to be scoring at least 40 goals, if you know what I mean, to be considered that.
But
he's not just a goal scorer. He's an all-around guy who will definitely score goals, and 30 should definitely be the target for him, at least 30. It should be to go over 30.
Yeah, but JJ's saying that we need another winger to score 30 goals. But he's talking about an outside winger, like a guy that we bring in, like a trade that we make. I think that that's kind of out of the realm of possibility at this point, unless they decide that they're going to trade one of Polak, Grice, or Berube to get that winger, because everybody knows that goaltending is a big thing right now.
This is my thing with that trade is, yes, if you can do it, and people have probably heard me talk about the crazy stuff about getting Ovechkin. We could do it. He would love it over there in Brooklyn with the Russians and hanging out. It'd fit right in. He'd wear his big mink jacket. You know what I mean?
That would be good. That would be absurd, though.
Yes,
he would be very
absurd with his tinted shit and all that.
No, I mean,
listen, I'm no Ovechkin fan, but if he was on Islanders,
have to give up probably like...
He's the best goal scorer in the league.
For a guy like Ovechkin, let's think about it this way.
Yeah.
A guy like Ovechkin, a guy that could score 45, 50 goals a game, has a lot of veteran experience, you're looking at probably one of our top defensive
But first
prospects.
Of all, Ovechkin is the only guy really like that, so it is
Mayfield,
Ovechkin.
Yeah, no, but I'm saying like
but yeah,
Ovechkin,
go ahead.
Like for example, like guys like Ovechkin, Malkin, Patrick Kane, you know, like the elite scorers that people are saying that we need. You
I don't
need,
think Kane's near as good
no,
as
No, but you're looking at Pulak. You're probably looking at, like, a combination of Pulak, Strom, and maybe, like, another prospect, and then you throw on Grabowski to make up for whatever cap hit we're going to get.
If that's what they said, I would do it 1,000 times over in a heartbeat. If you have Ovechkin playing with Tavares, nothing else will matter. It doesn't matter if you're me playing on the with them. It doesn't even matter if you have just you cut off my finger and put them on the wing with them. Two of them will be the best friggin' tandem that there is in the league. If, you know, we're going to win the cups and all this, we could, sure enough, we could have the team already where we're going to win. But the thing is, you know, I just feel like if we shot even higher, you know, shot to be even better, you know, obviously it would make our chances better. And this is the thing is, if you give up these other guys, we got other guys that'll come in and fill the shoes of the third liners. And the, you know what I mean? And the extra, we got three good goalies out there. Four, even if you count this Sorokin guy who's ripping up the KHL.
We probably have more young goalies than we know what to do with, which is a surprise.
Let them take a goalie
been
or two.
So bad with goalies in our history, probably since what, Westfall? Like, since DP's first injury?
Oh, don't get started.
Yeah. No, but I'm just saying, like, that was probably where all of our goaltending troubles just kind of
snowballed
into an avalanche. Yeah. You know, but like,
it was supposed to be the same.
But basically, what I was saying was that you're gonna need like Strom, Pulak, Lee, Mayfield. You're looking at least four or five guys.
That's okay.
Some picks.
You know what? Throw in 5 first-round draft picks. It don't matter. For 5 years, you ain't going to need a draft pick.
It's not...
If you got Ovechkin and Tavares, you could change everybody else on the team.
But
you don't need a draft pick.
But that's
put
even
in a bunch
to get Washington
kids.
To think about the idea. That's not even to, like, make it a done deal. Unless Washington approaches us with that kind of deal, then yeah, it's a done deal. But otherwise, at this point, we're not really going to get
a guy like
that through trade.
I know that we're not going to get him. I know, because Washington ain't going to give him up is the reason why. But listen,
no,
if
but I'm saying like in general,
he would,
like
he would
any
maybe
kind want to
leave coming up now.
Like getting a guy like Jordan Eberle or a guy.
Yeah.
I mean, the Taylor Hall trade, I still think is ridiculous. I don't know how the Oilers thought Adam Larson was a better defenseman. But, I mean, that's another story for another day. Basically, the thing is that this is most likely going to be our roster. We're probably not going to go out there and trade for somebody unless Garth Snow decides, you know what, we can't have these three goalies be here the entire year again because our number one goaltender is unhappy about it, and we don't know, we're still trying to figure out how to work it in, so let's trade one of these guys, get either a top pick back, get either a pick back or a veteran with like an expiring contract that's kind of underperforming.
But the thing is then, like JJ was saying, is there room for Barros along the lineup for forward? If you bring in another guy, somebody else has got to leave because there's barely even room for Barros
That's the point.
So.
Like, you can't have it both ways. You can't
get
a 30-goal scoring veteran and have Barros make the team. You gotta have one or the other.
That's why I should trade for Ovechkin.
Personally,
get rid of some of the guys and bring in some of the kids like
Barzal.
I mean,
if everybody wants Barzal that badly,
yeah. I want to see
him. I'd take the risk of having him on the roster if he beats out everybody else from camp.
Yeah.
But at the same time, if he's not ready, he's not ready. And if we don't, and if nobody's offering a 30-goal scorer.
I don't think anybody is at this point. So you're basically set. We're being realistic in the end.
Andersley has to continue to play as well as he did before he broke his foot, thanks to a Johnny Boychuk slap shot. But hey, that's the risks. As long as he's not afraid of going to the net, like Brock Nelson seemed to have gotten last year after having his knee almost broken, you could say, by Boychuk slap shot. I mean, we need those big bodies in front on the power play. So you put Nelson and Lee out there, you're definitely going to get goals. And those are the two guys that you're definitely going to need to get at least 25 to 30 goals out of. Ryan Strome, to me, I would be perfectly okay with 20 goals and like 35 assists. Because
I hope he gets at least 25 after that contract.
No, but if he's a center.
Yeah.
He's got to be setting up those guys.
That's true.
He's got to be setting up those guys and then taking the shot when he has the opportunity to. He can't just...
Points, you're right, though. Points is what it's all about, not just goals. But somebody's got to score the freaking goal. Otherwise, nobody gets the assist.
Oh, no, exactly. No, so, but I'm saying that Ryan Strom kind of slacked off at points last year. So hopefully with this new contract...
He had some really good points, too, though.
But hopefully with this new contract, we don't have to be on him the entire time.
Yeah.
And we could focus more on how we're going to ease Barzal into the league if he makes the team out of camp. I mean, to me, even if Barzal does make the team, I would have no problem with carrying 14 forwards. I mean, because that way you'll be able to rest guys at key points without making an emergency call up to Bridgeport.
Yeah.
You figure we have the six defensemen. You keep a seventh defenseman if we get rid of one of the three goalies.
Yeah.
You have the 14 forwards. You could keep Prince, Grabowski.
It's a good problem to have in a way, you know? Like, that's
I mean,
that's
luckily,
what they say,
like, a good problem. Luckily, the bright side is that Quine signed a two-way deal. So Quine will probably be the first guy.
Yep.
Yeah. He'll be the last guy sent packing and the first guy called up, which is great because Quine really stepped things up last year.
Big
and
time.
He proved that he could be a guy that could really contribute up here.
You're so far.
No, like the red wine. Alan Quine, it's up to you. Orange and blue all of the time. Alan Quine, it's up to you. Orange and blue. All of the time, Alan Clark. Yes. Oh my God. Yeah. No, he stepped it up big time last year, though. Definitely. That's the thing is, you know, also Prince stepped it up big time last year. So, you know, it's hard if you're thinking about Barzal coming up, which I'm thinking about him possibly coming up too to start the season, though. I don't know about to start the season. When comes down to it, in reality, he probably won't start the season yet.
But
unless even Petrov, though, last year, he had a great camp, and he didn't start the season with the team. I feel like if he had, and they gave him the chance, and they put him on the line with the other two Russians, Grabowski and Cooley, right off of the thing, maybe they would have been the best second line in the league. But we'll never know.
I mean, obviously, they saw some things in Petrov, probably whether it's like off-ice workouts and stuff.
Yeah.
Like there could be some things that we just didn't see.
Yeah.
That
well,
the team
frowned
upon,
to the
and
KHL.
That's why
he's accustomed
why he
to the KHL too. So I think that they were really trying to say, listen, we want to get you more fitted into this thing, and he felt like, oh, I'm frustrated.
In the way that they put
it.
Yeah,
and he was like, fuck
also,
it.
Like, the KHL, the game is completely different.
Yeah, it's
game.
Completely different.
Their ice is so big.
Well, it's not that much. I was at a KHL game. It's not that much bigger.
No, but it is bigger.
It is
bigger. They play an entirely different style.
Well, yeah,
that's what Westfall said.
They play a different style, yeah, big time.
He fits the mold of a KHL hockey player. He's a particular Russian hockey player. So, you know, that doesn't always mean that you're going to become an NHL superstar. I mean, I'm the biggest Jeff Tambellini fan there ever was. AHL... Banger, 30 goals. See, Jeff, I see you, baby. 30 goal score. You know, gets called up. Scores a hat trick. Gets scratched the next day.
Yeah.
You know?
Was it Scott Gordon? Was it Scott Gordon?
Yeah.
Right?
I think that was right before the
overspeed,
fired him.
Right? Was that overspeed?
Overspeed. That was overspeed.
The need for overspeed.
That was right before they fired him, too.
Yeah.
Because right after they scratched Tambellini, that's when we went 0 for November.
Yep. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
No win November.
Oh.
Now we have Yes-vember. Yes-vember. Yes-vember.
Woo!
But first, it's going to be Barktober. Ooh.
Yes-vember. That's awesome.
Barktober.
And, like, I was really impressed with Shane Prince last year.
Yeah, big time.
The guy comes over in a trade. Everybody's like, this was our big deal.
Yeah.
This is the guy. This guy's supposed to do everything for us. And, you know, he delivered, I think.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think he really gave us something to be happy with. We got him for cheap. He scored some big goals in some big moments. He seemed to always be on the ice when we needed him to be. You always saw him there.
Yeah, and to me, I didn't even really know of him. I hadn't heard of him until we got him. And then, you know, of course, like a lot of guys, if you don't know of the guy, then you look him up on the YouTube and this and that. And I was like, maybe. To me,
I love you, Chris.
To me, I thought
you're my boy, dude. He's like, bring back Chris Justin DiBenedetto. Phil, you hear this, man? Come on, Phil, say something to this guy. Get him out of here, man. Go watch the Canadians, man. Freaking PK Subban, freaking Avatar, look at motherfucker over there. Come on, man. Damn, dude. Bring back Subban. Bring back Subban. What you doing? Get off our freaking podcast. Damn, dude. I love you, though, man. I love you. This guy is hilarious. Are you going to watch every week? Just keep posting random stuff. Yo, bring back Niles. Bring back.
hey, bring back Niles. Like I said, I'll wear the damn suit.
Oh, man.
No, that's somebody awesome. Wear the suit. I don't want to actually wear it. Yeah. Fucking be hot in under there.
Yeah, right.
Sweat my balls off every room.
I mean, Shane Prince definitely delivered. Definitely. Said. You know, like that was probably one of the biggest surprises of the season because everybody's looking at guys like Ryan Strome and Anders Lee, Brock Nelson. They did not have a good season, let's be honest. I mean, Lee was coming along strong until he broke his foot. That's the way I thought about him.
Yep.
But otherwise, Strome was kind of underperforming at times.
Oh, yeah, 17
Denny
points?
Was fantastic.
17?
The way that I was just looking at it, it looks like...
I think so.
You got to figure
but, I mean,
Prince
like,
is in there.
Was kind of out.
You got to figure Prince is on the third line after what he was doing for us last year. I mean, I guess it's going to really... A lot of this is going to depend off how they do in camp. You know what I mean? This is how it happens. And then...
No,
they're going to have to make their own beds, you know? Yeah, and maybe somebody doesn't set their alarm clock. Yeah. Maybe somebody shows off and they get 5 goals in a game and they bring them out. Who knows?
I mean,
but it's too tight of a race at the bottom. And that's, like you were saying, that's a good problem to have because these guys are going to give each other competition. It's only going to make them come up
and
be better.
And I mean, I know a lot of people will be thinking, you know, why are we putting Josh Bailey on the second line? And, you know, the real reason that Josh Bailey will end up being on the second line is because, if you think about it, him and Kuhlman at this point are the only two defensive-minded forwards on our roster right now. I mean, you got the Killer C's, which they could play both ways. Cizikas is very solid defensively, but for the most part, Bailey and Kuhlman, they're our two best defensive players.
Forward.
Our defensive-minded forwards.
Bailey
so
played,
going to have to
get... It says here, in the season, Bailey played 81 games, and number 12 had 12 goals.
Yep.
He had 20 assists for 32 points. And he was a -7. He ain't good enough for the second line if he plays like that again.
If he plays like that again, he needs to be gone. But the thing is at the same time, is that it's just the second line on paper. You don't know how Capuano is going to work those lines.
Yeah.
You could say, yeah, this is our second line, but then, you know, you could have the Killer C's out there following John Tavares' line, then John Tavares' line, then the Killer C's, and then you're just like, when is Bailey stepping out on the ice? Then we finally realize, oh, hey, there's Josh Bailey. We start the chant. Line change. Kind of like what happened the entire season at points.
Well, but listen, that's the thing. It's funny that you say that because that did happen all last season with his chant.
Every
and you know
time.
What? That's why. Because he was like a ghost out there. He wasn't visible doing shit.
That's,
you didn't see him doing anything. There's his
stats
prove it.
Stats prove
it. His
you
stats,
know,
and you know, stats don't always show everything, but damn, these stats are pretty much showing exactly what it felt like I was watching last year at every single game, every away game, watching on TV or watching it, you know, at the Bark at home games.
I mean, I'm not
it
gonna
It felt
lie.
Like he
Josh,
was, he wasn't really
Josh
there
Bailey
that much.
Definitely took a step back last year when we needed him to be one of those leaders. And now with Okposo gone and Franzi gone, the spotlight's really going to be on Bailey because he's the longest tenured Islander now.
And I'm going to have to flip a 180
really,
on my thoughts
really
with Bailey.
That's really what's going to
yeah,
be the case.
I agree.
Bailey is the longest tenured Islander.
Yeah.
And he's going to have to show how important he feels he is to this team. I mean, you know, we chant his name night in and night out to provide him the support.
Mm-hmm.
Last year, you know, it was there at times. It wasn't there at other times. This year, he has to play more consistently. And I think that the fact that Franzi is gone, the guy that Bailey was best with. Bailey and Franzi were a shutdown team defensively. Didn't really seem to work out that well last year, but, I mean, there were a lot of things that went wrong last year. for the team, and while a lot of things that went right. Years.
So, you know, they're entitled to an off year almost at that point.
Yeah, I feel like Bailey is going to be that guy that says, you know what, send me out there against Ovechkin. You know, like, he's going to be that guy that has to step up.
Yeah, I like
that. If it's not going to be him guarding Ovechkin, it'll be Kuhlman on Ovechkin. Somebody, one of our players has to step up and just shield them. You know, like, we have to have Bailey or Kuhlman be on guys like Crosby, Malkin, Ovechkin, Patrick Kane, Jonathan Toews. Those, they're going to have to shut those guys down. And if Bailey manages, I don't even care if Bailey manages only 5 goals and like 25 assists. If he's a plus 17 at the end of the year while shutting those guys down, the points won't really matter as much to me.
Well, yeah, if he changes the type of player that he is more, but then he should really be on the third line and definitely not the second. If you're on the first or the second line, you need to have assists or goals or both.
But again, the lines really don't matter. It depends. Like, the lines are just how the roster is announced.
Yeah, but for us, Capuano loses an entirely different game plan. I agree, but for us, though, it's more like the fourth line is the second line, kind of, really. You know what I mean? Because they're used a lot, you know what I mean? Yeah. But no, what I mean is the least used line, which is really the third line. The third line is the least used line on the team. Tavares' line is used the most, along with Clutterbuck's line.
Yeah.
So, and then you have whichever line is doing better out of the other two usually prevails and gets a little bit more ice time, and the other one usually gets, you know, the minimum.
Unless the other line has a specific job to do. Like, exactly. If Bailey's line, like, say that we have a line of Bailey, Kuhlman, and Ryan Strome. Say that that's our line next year. That line is going to be a defensive first line. That line will be out there against Rick Nash. That line will be out there against Sidney Crosby.
That line is going to be the shutdown line.
And that's going to be when Bailey really needs to step up. He has to be better defensively and take the spotlight that was surrounding Franz Nielsen and his defensive stalwart. Mm-hmm. And him and Kuhlman together, they have to become a shutdown tandem.
I agree, and I think
Bailey's on the penalty kill, so that's how you know that Bailey's already a good defensive-minded player.
If he focuses more on the penalty kill and he's on the line that's, you know, technically the third line maybe, but, you know, the least used line, and, you know, he just does his role, and his role is a little bit altered, because up until now, his role, he was always expected to put up points. But if you say, he was always expected to put up points. Yeah, but this is my thing, if you take that off of his shoulders, right, and then he doesn't put up as many points and he does other things really good, you know what he's going to be? Kyle Oposo. He's going to be Kyle Oposo, Kyle the Exile. He's going to be fucking, you know, everybody, he was supposed to be this way, but even though if he's really good at other things, it doesn't matter at that point, because you're not going to ever meet the expectations that originally people had for you.
But the thing is that everybody at this point should know that their original expectations of Josh Bailey are just insane, you know?
Same thing should have been with Oposo, but a lot of people on our fan base, they don't care about what you should
Oposo
do.
Oposo was a little bit different. Oposo actually had the scoring capabilities and wasn't afraid to shoot the puck.
Yeah.
Bailey, a little hesitant to shoot the puck.
Definitely hesitant.
Yeah, but, you know, like, he's...
Kyle Oposo, too. He might want to do a couple more toe drags first and then lose the puck.
But, you know, like, Oposo was drafted to be that top-scoring winger to be paired with John Tavares. He didn't really pan out to be that well. You know, like, he was good at times, but then it seemed like there were moments where he just wasn't all there.
Well, he was even before Tavares.
He lost
Tavares.
His strength, I think, before... Yeah,
he was before Tavares. I remember going watching him in Bridgeport when he was on the Sound Tigers, and he was supposed to be the one. He was supposed to be Jerome McGinley, is who Tavares was supposed to be.
No, but I was saying, like, he was drafted to eventually end up being that number one top winger with who eventually was John Tavares.
Yes.
It was Oposo, Tavares. They were supposed to be hand in hand. Everything was supposed to work out, but that just wasn't the case. Okposo kind of, I feel like he got a little scared after his shoulder injury, because he didn't seem to have the power moves that he used to have. Like, his toe drags weren't really as defined as they were before the shoulder injury, you know?
Yeah.
So I feel like that's part of the reason why he kind of slacked off a little, like why he wasn't really as good as he was before that.
I agree. Well, there's only so much that we can talk about all the players, though, because we got to see what they're going to do this year coming up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And first, early. Even before, yeah, it's early. It's even in camp, we got to see, you know what I mean? This is just prospects game tomorrow anyways, so. But yeah, we're all pumped as it goes anyways, you know? We could fucking
do this for hours.
Yeah, fucking all about the Islanders. That's what it's all about. Ooh! And the New York Islanders. Yeah! So, yeah, I mean, you know, we'll be looking forward to that. And, you know, we're gonna try and do this every week. We're going to try and keep it consistent, probably like, you know, 7 o'clock, you know, on Tuesday nights. We'll see if, you know, depending on game days, we'll see how it goes and everything. And, you know, as things go, we'll have other guests come on, too. We appreciate Westfall coming out here, of course, big time, you know.
I mean, it wouldn't be right to have the first podcast without Westfall.
Yeah, literally, he's the OG, you know what I mean? Triple OG is what I say. He's like, you know, the original general. That's what it is, you know what I mean? Like, you know, a lot of people know, you know, we got a bunch of leaders in the group and everything.
He was
targeted
before it was cool.
Yeah, and just, you know, I didn't get to say before when we were talking about it, and I won't go into it too much, but just at least when I first met Westfall, because, you know, just briefly, when I was in 318J1 was my old season ticket, and I could hear you guys over there doing a couple of chants. It was the Doug Waite chant. I could hear Doug Waite, Doug Waite, Doug Waite, Doug Waite, Doug Waite, Doug Waite.
We had a lot of simple chants back then.
Yeah, there were some good simple ones, though.
They were
very
simple. Too bad none of those caught on.
We still do those, though, throwback chants.
Every once in a while.
But I was able to hear you guys from over there, and this was before we had Tavares even, and I could hear you guys chanting for Tavares, and I was like, this guy's over there nuts. And I was over there with a couple other people, like Gina and Jordan and Rusa and the Pirate Eye Patch guy and the friggin'. they would sing the song, you go, Arg! And, you know, the Booster Club, Gary Harding, what's up, Gary? And, his wife too. They're very good people. Still see them around. I was talking to them recently on a little chat thing. But, I was over there and I could hear it. So, it was the last game of the regular season. I went over there just for the second period because I was one of those guys, I want to go with Islanders are shooting twice. So, I was like, oh, I'll go there in the second period when they're shooting over there. Who cares about all that shit? You know, it's better over there anyway. That's the corner where Bobby Nystrom, Mr. Islander himself, who was skating with 2 days ago on the Barclays Center ice, when he scored the goal, he went and celebrated in the corner right under where 329 is, right there in that glass. John Tonelli come up, grab him, they're celebrating, and we're all going crazy. I wasn't even born yet, but I was still all going crazy.
Crazy.
And I was born during the dynasty. So anyways, I heard them over there. I went over there for that second period. I see Pinhead, who's the most noticeable dude, you know, right when I walk up, and I'm like, what's up, man? I introduce myself to him, and I'm like, can I come up there and hang out and this and that? And he's like, yes, of course, you know, the more the merrier. And, you know, then I don't know, it wasn't right away, I don't feel like, but it wasn't long after at all when I met Westfall, and I was like, oh, this guy's fucking nuts, because I was nuts anyways, and me and him got along right away because of it, like fucking right off of the bat we were getting along, and then, you know, all that I had to find out was that we were partying in the tailgate for a pregame too, and I was like, all right, it was all over from there. We were tailgating every game, you know, we'd meet up, like, craziness, and
so
the tailgates just got bigger and bigger and bigger, and you know, that's the rest was all history, still being wrote. Yeah, the snowstorms, all those good times. But yeah, it's been crazy times, you know what I mean? A lot of crazy times that I was through with Westfall back there. Lots of crazy times. One in particular that I always remember when we were pre-gaming, when I really was like, I don't know, like it was happening, and I was like, is this happening? And it might seem so simple to so many people, but we were on the other side of the fence by the Marriott.
Okay.
And it was a bunch of us, and we were just over there, and we were throwing the beers on the Marriott after we were finishing them. Fuck it. We ain't over there no more. We were fucking around. We were just fucking going crazy. People walking by. Whoever we were playing, it was, you know, other people walking by, and we were just chanting at them and having fun. And, you know, we were just having a good-ass time, and it was just something about it. It was so fucking crazy. And then ever since then, you know, everything has just grown and grown and grown. And it's good that it has, because it's been damn fun watching it happen and being a part of it, too. And I know that, you know, everybody in the group, I know you all feel the same way. Fun times, all of us being a part of it. And, you know, we're all looking forward to that start of the season. Want everybody to make sure that you come super extra loud and proud this year, though, so we cheer them on to that fifth ring that Ledecky keeps on talking about. We got to do our part up there in the Blue and Orange Army. Absolutely. You're hearing the drum bang, you're hearing somebody chant, you're going to chant with them. You see somebody not chanting, you give them a little boom, a little nudge. Not so hard. That might have been a little bit too hard. But you give them a little nudge. We get them going. Let's go. Islanders. Oh, but yeah.
I think you could have knocked somebody out with that.
It was like 3D to the camera. I saw that in the thing. We could see ourselves as this is going. Early technology here for the first episode. Sorry for the super low quality and all that good stuff. But yeah, it's been good stuff.
Absolutely.
We'll be looking forward to what comes up with the team next. And I guess that we're going to wrap it up. And next week we'll be touching more on the games that had passed, which will include the game on Monday, which will be at the Barclays Center, right?
Yeah. And that one is at the Barclays
Center. Is at the Barclays Center. Confirmed.
Against Philadelphia. Before you ask me a fifth.
Yes, against Philly. So obviously we'll be at McMahon's for that one. Everybody knows. Make sure you come down and meet us over there. It's going to be fun times. I'm going to do it up. You know, can't wait to get back and rock the Bark. Good time skating with everybody that made it out on Sunday. That was great. You know, we got to skate with Bobby Nystrom. If any of you that are not full season ticket holders out there, you think that you don't get perks, you get perks. You know, you can get them. And even if you are a full season ticket holder, check your damn emails. Make sure that you're getting it. And look on that Facebook page. You know where we're at. We keep everything up to date there. Anybody else that ain't involved in there yet, you know what to do. Come up to the section and come and hang out and chant and cheer. You know what I mean? Come up there, introduce yourself. And just the same as when, like I was saying, when Pinhead welcomed me up, it's the same way today. You know, we're very welcoming. That's why the group grows. Not just because we all love the Islanders, but because we're welcoming to fellow Islander fans that are also feeling super passionate, want to get out there and chant and cheer.
Also, we have an usher that will actually let people into the section to hang out with us, unlike the other ushers in the arena that will say, that's not your seat, go someplace else.
Well, no, yeah, our usher, he's the best. Lewis, you know, he's not saying, T-Bone's not saying he's going to not do his job, you know.
I mean, he's going to do his job.
Yes, he's going to do his job for
but,
sure.
But if
we've seen it, but he
usually ends up going off of if we give that person clearance at this point.
In a way, as long
there
as there's room.
Guys, yeah.
As long as there's
no,
the
long
extra
there's
seats
room,
and everything, yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, I don't want to try and get Lewis in trouble here.
No. That's why I also wasn't mentioning his name, in case they didn't see this.
Nah, well, we all know who he is. Lewis is the best, man. He's the best. He's the best up there. But no, yeah, he's doing his job. He ain't getting in trouble. He ain't doing nothing wrong. But yeah, no, what T-Bone's saying is, you know what I mean, don't feel shy. If, you know, you see some room up there, come up there. You know, we'll try and squeeze you in if we can.
Yeah.
Just like it happened when we were in 329, the same way.
Oh, boy.
We're keeping the whole thing rolling. Actually,
just,
not as much as 329 because
there's more space in the back row.
Yeah, there's a lot more space. 329, I don't know. You guys, I'm positive you remember. But the times when we were double and triple stacked and you couldn't stand on seats at all because the friggin' thing was already hit on the ceiling, then the back row. So you had to literally, in the back row, somebody would be sunk back where the seat was, standing up tight, and then somebody would be right in between them, filed in like that, and the next one filed in like this, and filed in like this. And you would make it work, and you'd have twice the amount of people in the back row. That's the back row boys.
And that was a tight time, man. We had a lot of space. No leg room.
The back row boys were drinking whiskey on fire.
We made it work.
Fireball, what's up, Craig? We're gonna do some shots of what? Ooh.
Yeah.
Yep. But yeah, like I was saying, it's been good. I guess that we touched on pretty much all the subjects that we wanted to for today. Yep. Been good times. Thank you everybody who watched. And
thanks everyone.
Yep.
Thanks.
It's all about the Islanders. You
Islanders!
Know the deal. We're just going to get ready for next week. And, oh, yeah, the only other thing that I wanted to say was it's all about the Islanders. Oh!